Just wanted to say thank you to everyone that's been giving me feedback on the last video. It's been really great to have so many people just reach out to me and offer advice, things they want to see, any questions that they've had. It's been really great. So thank you so much for getting in touch with me. I'm going to do my best to address as many questions as possible. So this video series, I'm going to try and focus on trying to get you stood up as quickly as possible in Unreal. I will be touching on some of the concepts Unreal has and then slowly exposing you to more and more of the features as we go through. So today's video, I'm going to talk about how to set up a camera for a character, how to set up the animation blueprint to read from that character. You remember last video, we set up the initial blueprint. We need to actually now tell it how to move the character left, right, up and down, do the animations for that. I'll try and do surface level as we start. I don't want to try and overwhelm people with too much information, but as we get further into the project and further into the series, I'll start expanding upon all these concepts. Right, so with that out of the way, let's get started. So last video, we implemented a character, got them moving around in the scene. One of the things that we need to do now is make it so they can actually look around with the camera. Right now, there's nothing set up, so let's get straight into that. Firstly, we want to create another input action, so right-click. Input action. We're going to call this IA look. And now we're going to go to the input mapping. So this is the thing that we set up yesterday that has the movement mappings. We're going to create a brand new map and we're going to drag in the input action for looking. So today we're going to show how to do it with a mouse, but you would have the same workflow if you were going to do it with a gamepad. What we're going to do is drop down, add an element. We're going to create the x-axis, so this is going to be similar to how we had the character movement, where W would be swizzled onto the y-axis. We're going to do the same here, so we're going to add the second element, drop down, mouse y. So this one we're going to add a modifier, and we're going to swizzle the input axis onto the y-axis. So x is going to be turned into the y-axis in this case. Let's hit save on that. Let's open up the IA look, which is the look action. So you see how the value type is digital, bool? We actually want this to be a vector 2D because we want it to be up, down, left, right. Okay, let's save that. If you remember the code from yesterday, it only handled the movement action. What we need to do now is extend this so we add a look action. So let's copy the code. So we're gonna create a second action. This one's gonna be look action and its handler is gonna be look input handler. So look input handler. Okay, so in the header, we're just gonna create that field that we need. So we're gonna create this as an edit anywhere with the same category, input binding, just so all the bindings are in the same place. So this is a uInput action, which is the pointer to it. And then this is gonna be a look action. And we want to initialize this value to something like null pointer, which is what that means. So this is just a tangent really. So in C++, you can assign variables like this. This is called a list initialization, and this is called a copy initialization. So there is a problem you can run into with type safety. If I was to make this an int32 and I'm gonna call it x, and then I type x equals 7.9, that is valid. That will actually just equate to 7. But if I do it as a list assignation, it will just fail to compile. This is because it's called narrowing, if you want to look into this on your own time. But this is why instead of doing the equals, I tend to assign with the list initialization. So whilst I'm here, I might as well talk about what this macro does. So if you want to expose a property to Blueprint or anywhere else, you would create a UPROPERTY and you would set it to edit anywhere. There are a few other types of properties you can have. So you can have visible anywhere. You see how there's visible defaults only, visible instance only. This will make it so it's basically read only, but you can see what the value is inside the editor. So if you have something set up in a code and you wanted to at runtime see what the value is, you could select the object in the outliner whilst the game is running and it would show you what the value has been set to. I don't really use it that often, but I've seen it used in other places. Personally, my two go-to are edit anywhere or edit defaults only. The only difference is when you open up a blueprint, you can edit it there. But if you have it set to edit defaults only, it's only editable there. If I go into the outliner of an object that's been placed in the scene, I can't edit the property unless it has edit anywhere. There are several others, but I'm just gonna touch on these two for now. Feel free to look into what these other ones do, but I don't wanna overwhelm with too much information. So for now, let's just stick with edit anywhere. Right, so now we have the look action in the header. go back to the code. So I pressed Control K and O to jump between the header and the C++ class. If you're on Visual Studio, you may have something similar. So now we need to create this function. This function is going to look very similar to this function. So what I'll do is if I press context actions, you can actually just create. So Write is really good at suggesting implementations for things. So you could just roll with this one. In this case, it's actually exactly what I need it to do. You'll see this yellow squiggly line underneath. This means it hasn't been implemented, but it's in the header. So I'm just gonna generate definition. So now we have the code generated. What we wanna do is get the value. So very similar to what we had before. Input action value, grab that. So instead of adding it to the movement input, what we wanna do is add this to the control input. With the control input, I'd almost imagine it like a camera in a first person game. That's not necessarily accurate to what it is, but that's how I would explain it to someone if they've never worked with controllers before. I will go into more detail as to what a controller is and what a character is and how the two interact with one another. But for now, add the control input. So we're gonna add this to the yaw and the pitch, and that's gonna look the camera up, down, left, and right. So let's start with adding it as the pitch. So we don't have to provide a vector for the direction here. What we just need to do is provide the actual value. So we already have X and Y. We have that passing in the values that we need. The X axis is going to be for left and right. The Y axis is for up and down. So we want this to change the yaw based on the X axis. And we then want to change the pitch based off of the Y axis. So controller pitch here. Okay, so now we hit save. Let's pop over back to Unreal. So now that code is all written, we want to hit the recompile button. Depending on the size of your project, this could take some time. As it's a very small project, there isn't really much to recompile. Okay, now let's finish recompiling. Right, let's go to the character, and we just need to now set the look action. So we don't have to change any of the mapping context because that's already been set. We already set that just now. So just hit save, and we should be able to press play. And now the mouse is able to look up and down, left and right. So there's one problem I've noticed here. Unless you like your games having the look up and down inverted, we're gonna need to do some changes here. So let's stop the simulation. Let's go back to input. Let's go back to player, the input mapping context for the player. And what we're gonna do is we've got the mouse Y value here. I'm just gonna add a quick negate on this. So here we go. Now down is down and up is up, left and right. You notice how the character isn't facing the direction we want. They're kind of offset 90 degrees from the direction we want. That's another thing we want to fix. But now we can move around, look up and down, and we're getting there. Okay, so now let's sort out the character's body and we'll position the camera so it's a bit further behind them. I want to have a third person character game. So this is something I'm going to change now. So go back to the gameplay folder, go to the character itself. And let's do ourselves a favor and open this up in the full blueprint editor. So viewport. So if you notice something here, the character isn't facing the direction of this arrow. This arrow is the forward direction of the character. It's on the x-axis forward. The mesh itself needs to be rotated minus 90 degrees on the z-axis. You don't have to do this all the time. It's just when you have artwork that has its forward direction set to the y-axis. You can change this with the asset import settings, but I'm going to just show you how to do it in here with the rotation, purely because I want to explain how you can change transforms of meshes and it doesn't actually tie to the capsule position or any of that. Anyway, so let's save and press play. So now the character is facing the right direction, but my camera is inside the body. I don't want that. So let's stop the game again. So what we want to do is open up the blueprint for the character. Go to components and press add. Now we want to type in camera and we just want to drop that into the scene. So now if you go into the viewport for the blueprint, you'll see that we have this camera component here. It's going to be used by the engine to figure out where you want to be rendering from. So when you possess a character that has a camera component within it, it's going to pick up the first one that's there. This will be positioned in local space to the blueprint. So for example, if I move it slightly further behind them, you'll notice how it's moving the transform of this scene component just slightly back behind the character. If I hit compile and save and press play, the camera is now directly behind the character's head. This might be fine in some scenarios, but because the camera doesn't have any collision, it's easy to clip into walls like this. So what I would suggest is adding a spring arm component, which is another component which acts, as you can imagine, like a spring. So what we'll do is we'll drag the spring arm component below the capsule component and then make the camera a child of the spring arm. So now the spring arm, you can see here, this is the desired length. You can change the target arm length here. So let's set this to 200. So we're going to also change this socket offset. So we're going to move it up on the Z axis. I'm just going to put it as 50. And then the camera, because we've moved the transform to begin with, we want to just reset that back to zero. So now it's going to be exactly where that spring arm is. Now I've seen it, let's just bump this up to 75. So it's just a bit further up. And now let's hit compile and save. So here we go. May look very similar to what we had just now, but if I was to quickly just shut this down and then add a basic shape. So let's add a wall. So what I'll do now is just quickly add a wall so I can show you what happens when the camera bumps into it. So if I just move the camera here, press play, move the character. If I bump into it, you see how the camera gets pushed forward. Without that spring arm, it would go straight through the wall. You still have the issue where if I get too close, it will intersect with both. But in this case, it doesn't seem to be causing any clipping on the character. So it doesn't look great right now because there's not any lag on the camera. It looks very stiff and rigid, but that's fine for now. What we need to do is press close. I want to see a bit more of the character. So what I'm going to do is pull the spring arm just a slightly further back. So I'm going to go to the viewport, target arm length, 350. And I just want to change the socket offset to 150. Another thing I want to do is add camera lag and rotation lag. This will just make it feel a bit more floaty as a camera, as opposed to being like stuck like a pole behind the character. So now it will drift a bit more. You can change all the settings of that here. So the camera itself, I like the field of view. I like the size of that for now. One thing I'm going to do is slightly angle that rotation downwards so it's facing more of the character. So minus 15 for that value. Hit save and play. So hit save and there we go. So you notice how with the lag, it's just slightly smoother. It feels a bit better as a player. So now we have this third person character running around with no animations. Normally this would be okay, but for me, I want to have a bit of movement on the character when I'm running around. So let's do the animations now. Let's stop the simulation. Let's open up the animation blueprint we created earlier. Double click. So we have these two values, horizontal and vertical. These are currently set to zero. So these values aren't being driven by anything right now. What we want to do is grab the character's input direction and then run the animations based on that. So if the character is moving forward in the world, we want to drive the blend space animation so it's also running forward in the world. Same as if they're running backwards or left or right. So to do this, we're going to open up the event graph. We're going to go to functions and we're going to go to override. And we're going to go to blueprint update animation. There are a couple of ways of doing this. One of them is considered thread safe, which actually makes it faster to execute than a traditional tick. But we'll dig into that in the future. What we're going to do is get the pawn that is running this animation blueprint. So if you remember in the character blueprint itself, we defined the animation class. This animation blueprint is going to be owned by that character. So because we know the owner of this animation blueprint is a pawn, we can use the function tryGetPawnOwner and then get the movement component out of it. This movement component is a thing that all pawns tend to have. So if I just open up the code, I'm just going to go to a pawn. All pawns have this function here called getMovementComponent. The base implementation will try and find a component of that class, pawnMovementComponent, on the actor itself. However, in the character version of this, the a character version, which our character has derived from, they have this getMovementComponent overridden. This returns the pointer to the character movement component, which is on that actor. So by default, all characters have this component here, the character movement component. So you may notice a slight difference between this component and the spring arm component that we just added. This is because this is a scene component. There's a slight difference in the sense that it has a transform. It can be moved around relative to the owning object. Whereas this is just a standard actor component, It doesn't have a transform, but it can be modified and has some properties to work with. Character movement components are actor components. That's why it's below this line here. So what we're going to do in the animation blueprint is try and get the pawn owner, get the movement component from it, and that movement component is going to give us a velocity. So if we do get velocity, this will be the speed that the actor is currently moving at. What we want to do now is feed that velocity into vertical and horizontal. So there's two ways we could do this. I could split out the X and Y and feed them into these variables, or I could change these values here into a vector too. For now, for simplicity's sake, I'm just going to set these two variables. So what I'm going to do is drag the variable and drop it onto this pin here. This will make it a setter for this value. You can also do this by grabbing the variable, dropping it on, and you see how it has this get or set. I want to set the value, so I'm going to press set. Now drag these two together. Now this is a vector. To get the floats out of that vector, we need to break the vector. Okay, so now we right click this pin and we press split struct pin, and then it will output the floats that are within that struct. I'll go into how to set up structs so they can be worked with in this way, but for now just know that vectors, they have this built in, so you can right click them and open up the internal components within that struct. There is another way of doing it, which is dragging off the pin and typing break, and that will break the vector. It's the same exact thing, it just looks simpler if you have it here. So for now, we know that X is horizontal and Y is vertical. So to recap, we have a blend space, which is driven by two variables, vertical and horizontal. If the vertical is positive, it's going to have the character run forward. If the vertical is negative, they're going to play the backwards animation. If it's horizontal, currently we have no animation set up on it, but we will in the future. So let's hit compile and save. Okay, so there's one thing you may be noticing here. This is currently executing, and there is no owning pawn or owning movement component. So how is this code running? In reality, what's actually happening here is it's failing to find this object. So if I was to breakpoint this by hitting F9, this is unknown, which means it doesn't have a value. So it's likely causing errors in the background. So what we actually want to do is protect against this value being invalid. So we can't call this function if this is null or invalid. So we're going to use the function is valid. This has an input pin and two output pins. We want to use the input pin, and then if it is valid, we will do this function here. We also want to guard the get movement component, because as you saw earlier, the base implementation of a pawn might not have a movement component associated with it. So we're going to do another is valid. So grab this pin and then that pin to there. So now we have two checks. Both of those things have to be valid before we set the speed. And you see here how it's not executing all the way through? That's because there is no pawn, so it can't check if there's a component. You may be wondering, if is this implementation slow? Yes and no. It's not the fastest implementation. I wouldn't recommend doing this for production-ready code. However, it's good enough for prototyping for now that there are going to be other things in the future that will be optimized before we start worrying about this. What I would tend to do is derive from the animation instance itself, create a new animation blueprint based off of that, and have this kind of logic done in native. But for now, just to show you how to do this, we can do it all in Blueprint. So let's compile and save, shut this editor down, and we're going to press play. So now, if I move forward, the character is playing their forward animation. If I press backwards, the character is playing their backwards animation. If I press A, there is no animation. If I press D, there is no animation. So this is because we need to set these animations up. That's what the next lesson is going to be. But thank you so much for watching. If you've had any questions throughout the entire thing, drop a comment. I will 100% respond. I've been trying to respond to the previous ones as quick as I can. I'm on Twitter. It's just D Goodale. So the next video is going to be a couple of days out. I cannot avoid... So sorry, if you know me in real life, you'll understand why. But yeah, I will be back probably next week with some videos explaining the rest of this process. But if you figure out how to do the transitional movements between the character going left and right, share it with other people, put it in the comments. I will signal boost it on Twitter if I can. But yeah, I'll leave it to you.